So now, let us catch our breath. The spirit that encouraged Mary and Joseph so long ago gives us all the breath that we need now, and let us worship God.
Anytime we gather to worship, we find ourselves in God's arms.
May we recognize that gift, and in doing so, may we dance with joy.
I dream of full tables and unstoppable laughter.
I dream of bear hugs and homemade art.
I dream of a sanctuary building with worshipers and that edge of your seat feeling before the soprano hits the high note.
I dream of friends and adventures.
I dream of every joy, joys that we know come straight from God.
Today, we light the candle of joy, the candle that signifies the joy from God's heart to ours, a reminder that God's dream is every tear wiped away and all things made new.
God's dream for this world is joy that is complete, that is contagious, that overflows.
So may this candle burn bright, and as it does, may we sing.
May we dance.
May we laugh.
May we sow joy in a hurting world, a defiant and brave joy that no darkness can chase away.
Together in joy, let us worship God.
Thank you.
Now we continue in worship with our prayer of confession, and I invite Sungju Park to lead us in that.
Let us confess our sins before God using the prayer of confession shown in your bulletin or on your screen. Joyful God, with a sky full of stars and a world full of flowers, we should be rejoicing. And yet somehow we seem to drop the joy you give, like loose change, and shrug ourselves into inaction. Instead of leaping with joy like Mary, or dancing in the streets like David, we pass by remarkable beauty and tremendous love unfazed. Starter us again with joy. Forgive us for joylessness in the face of your splendor.
Amen. Friends, hear again the good news of the gospel. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. The joy that is given to us by Jesus Christ is larger than any sorrow in this world. It will wipe away every tear from every face. The darkness cannot, will not, and has not overcome it. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and freed for a life of service and singing and joy and dancing and rejoicing, no matter what. And that gives us a moment of peace. And we pass that peace that we know in the Lord one to another with the sort of cheesy but adorable, beautiful way of waving at each other in these screens and paying attention to the people who are still with us, scrolling through the screens, remembering that our friends are still very much our friends. We are a community in Christ. We are the body of Christ stretching across an entire nation right now. Thanks be to God. And those faces and names that we're missing right now, that gives us a call, a phone call that we make just to say, I'm thinking of you, I love you. That peace comes your way. Together now, freed and rejoicing people, let's sing the Gloria Patri together.
From Prophet Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 61, verses 1 through 4 and 8 through 11. Listen to the word of God. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring good news to the oppressed, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to provide for those who mourn in Zion, to give them a garland instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the mantle of praise instead of a faint spirit. They will be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord to display his glory. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. For I, the Lord, love justice. I hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully give them their recompense, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. Their descendants shall be known among the nations, and their offspring among the peoples. All who see them shall acknowledge that they are a people whom the Lord has blessed. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with a robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. Here ends the readings from God's word.
Thank you so much. And now it is time for children of all ages here in our Zoom congregation to gather around your screens as we gather for the children's message. As we begin, I'd like to call on Pastor Becca and Grace to help me out with the fourth of the prayer that we're about to share as we always pray at the beginning of our children's time together. So together, let us put our hands together and close our eyes and bow our heads, and let us come to God in prayer. Repeat after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
We love you.
We love you.
We want to hear from you.
We want to hear from you.
Help us to listen.
Help us to listen.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, boys and girls and everyone gathered here, we're about to hear a passage of scripture that's very famous that Pastor Becca is going to read and then preach a sermon on. And it is a hymn of praise. It is a song of joy that Mary sings after she's learned from the angel that she is going to be the mother of Jesus. And then after she's visited with her cousin Elizabeth, who's also going to give birth to a baby whom we know will be John the Baptist. So it is a time of celebration and joy to learn all this good news of the coming of life into the world, and especially the coming of God into the world. But Mary, she's not in just a joyful, happy, safe situation. She is a young woman, a teenager, really, kind of an older teenager, maybe. She's not married yet. She's engaged, but she's not married yet. But now she's going to have a baby. So it's kind of awkward. But she's full of joy still because she's going to be doing something huge for God. God trusts her to be the mother of Jesus. God did not say, you know, she's just a little kid. God did not say she's just a little girl. God took Mary seriously, trusted Mary, and God puts Mary to work. And Mary is so taken with this. At first, she's not sure she can believe it, but then she's told, you found favor with God. You're important to God. You matter. And, you know, there's rich folks. There's folks who have all the power in the world. God says, I'm not going to work through them. I'm working through you, through a little girl, through a kid. You're important to me, and you can do this. And the rich, for all their wealth and their status, they can go suck lemons. We don't care. Mary was perhaps somebody others thought of as a poor nobody, but God chose her and not someone rich and famous, not someone important, to be Jesus's mother. And all this leads me to wonder, you know, do you all realize all the children here? Hey, all the grown-ups here. Do you realize that God thinks we're all capable of doing amazing things for God? No matter what our age, no matter what gifts or talents we think we have or don't think we have, God says, you can do this. God says, you matter. God says, I've got big plans for you. You know, I'm wondering, you know, maybe, you know how people sometimes get special t-shirts for occasions, for slogans, for events or movements that they're a part of? I wonder what t-shirt Mary would have. What would be on Mary's t-shirt after she learned she's going to be the mother of Jesus? I'm going to ask our Zoom administrator, Sophia, to maybe give a couple of possibilities on the screen. Oh, there they are. God loves us. God has big plans. And it could say, God has big plans for us. I want you to imagine, what would your t-shirt be for what God wants to do with and for and through you? Because God has great plans for Mary. God has great plans for all of us. And it is something to be joyful about as we think of how it is that even in the midst of a lot of sorrow or difficulty or pain, we can rejoice that God is with us and God's going to do great things with us and through us. And God always wants to be in touch with us, to talk with us. And Jesus gave us a special prayer to pray, prayer we call the Lord's Prayer. And let's close our time together with that prayer. So again, put your hands together and close your eyes and bow your heads. And with the whole church, we'll pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our second scripture lesson today is the Magnificat. It comes from the Gospel according to Luke. And I'll be reading beginning at the 46th verse of the first chapter. Listen now for the word of the Lord. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has looked with favor on the lowliness of his servant. Surely from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. His mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He's brought down the powerful from their thrones and filled up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise he made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me and for me? Oh Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. This week, our story starts with Mary. And as Stephen said, she was pregnant and afraid. She had lost sleep and might have bitten off her nails. She was anxious about whether Joseph would leave her, whether her community would shame her or project all over her or completely reject her. And by this point in the text, Mary had made her way to Elizabeth's house. Elizabeth was also pregnant and probably afraid. According to Luke 1:24, Elizabeth had been in seclusion for 5 months, unable to celebrate this momentous milestone of a long-awaited baby in community, in her community. More aware of her age and risk class than ever before, while her husband, Zechariah, had been on mute the entire time. Seclusion, being on mute, thick uncertainty. That sounds very familiar, doesn't it? So all of the pent-up fear, all the loss, all the hormones springing out from the weight of history that they knew they were part of, all of it just came tumbling out in their greeting. Can you imagine, can we imagine the joy in that reunion? Can we feel that joy in our gut? Can we feel the tears catch in our throat when a promise made swells into actual joy on the way? I mean, it's too much, honestly. It's too much for a narrative. It's too much for just stating the facts. Too much for Luke to report this in his gospel with some linear Greek text. I mean, the news of this child, the news of any child, especially an against all odds child, it's more than a baby registry. It's more than a pink or blue announcement in the mail or more than a cute Facebook post. It's the tears on your face when you finally talk to the person who gets it the most. It's the jumping up and down. It's him territory. It's a relief that explodes from your body. It's the moment in a musical when the narrative stops and time stops and the spotlight stops on one person who bursts into song. That is the Magnificat. That is Mary's song. And in researching for the sermon, I did the text study like I always do. And Magnificat, it means magnifies. Magnifies. I learned that Mary's song was likely a hymn passed around Christian communities from the earliest church. Her song had already become their song. And our Bible study group hovered over this text, noting how cosmic Mary's joy was. It was a joy much bigger than saying, oh, what a nice day this has been. We talked about the grand reversals that Mary sings about, the poor lifted up, the proud scattered, the old order yielding, the new day crashing in. And that shifted the tone of our conversation too. The kind of joy you feel or sing rather than think about or write about. And so members of this congregation shared with me what joy has found them this year. Joy is the sound of grandchildren's voices when they delight in having thwee whithmith tweeth. Joy is your sons shaking hands on Thanksgiving when they'd been at odds for years. Joy is like the blue sky seen through bare tree branches or blossoms like pink fists already pressing out of bushes, ready to bring spring one day. Joy is a phone call with a dear friend and feeling understood Joy is working in a long-term care facility and offering care to seniors and knowing how essential that work is. Joy is hearing that cancer is in remission. Joy is mountains of link food. Joy is a PTA parent donating a kidney to a teacher at the school for Christmas. Joy is fingers on a guitar for the first time in decades. Joy is hearing your rare disease 2-year-old squeal from her crib, "Maymay woke up." And knowing what a precious gift those words are. Joy is Christmas lights going up 3 weeks early and Grammy's overflowing bubble bath and hummingbirds and cats who walk on a computer and the unconditional love of dogs. And joy's like hearing your loved one's voice in your heart, even after they have left this earth. Joy is sunshine on your face. It's the kind of joy that's bigger than prose. It demands music and poetry and art. It breaks us open and rushes through us to the point of tears and sings us into the symphony of God in Christ, reordering our lives and this entire world toward amazing grace and freedom and redemption. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote about this kind of joy in his Advent writings from inside a concentration camp. He said that the door to joy and freedom is unlocked from the outside, and we trust that it is Christ who is unlocking us. A pastor friend of mine said, "When I get in a funk or cynical, my wife always tells me I need to go visit someone who is hurting or lonely." And this works always because we must care for ourselves and do the things that we should do. But these places where Jesus takes us, they are the hilly dirt paths that lead to joy. That kind of joy takes the whole stage. It gets us out of our heads and asks that all other mortal flesh keep silent, including preachers. And so I hope you'll indulge me as I imagine Mary's song this year, this way. A break from prose. When a version of this song was sung in Hamilton, it was sung by two men, Alexander Hamilton and Aaron Burr, and they were singing to their children. And this year I played with the words to imagine two women, Elizabeth and Mary, singing to God about their children. And we'll play it now. And while we listen, think about the Holy Spirit joy that has found you this year.
Spirit, what to say to you? You have my life. You gave me mother's eyes when you came, my soul magnified, and it grew my heart. I'm dedicating this joy to you. Domestic life was never quite your style. When you smile, you change the world, greed falls apart. You chose a humble start. They will speak of me in generations. They'll bleed and fight for you and be made right through you. You are our sure and strong foundation. We'll pass love on for you. We'll serve the poor for you, and you'll show us all the way. Sunday, Sunday. look at your son. Pride is not the word I'm looking for. My child leaps inside of me now. Oh, Elizabeth from star to morning sun. Our sons, when they come, new life will start and dwell in every heart. Our Father's always around, our Father's love will abound. I swear this love will astound you. We'll do whatever it takes, we'll make a million mistakes. You'll make the world turn around toward you. He will come of age and rock the nations. He'll wear a cross for you, throw the tomb off for you. Live inside this revelation. There's grace and might for you, a whole new light for you, and he'll show us all the way. Someday, someday. Yeah, he'll show us all the way.
Amen. Now, with having shared some of our joys in that chat ball of joy that we just shared on the chat function, and with all that is in our hearts on this third Sunday of Advent, Joy Sunday, Let us come to our God in our prayers and know that we are remembering in our prayers those who are in our Trinity cycle of prayer, Sheila Brown, Sophia and Danny Brown and their daughter Olivia, Lisa and Charles Broyhill and their sons Cole and Luke, Debbie Bergener, and in our Presbyterian cycle of prayer, the United Christian Parish of Reston and the United Korean Presbyterian Church in Bethesda, Maryland. And we rejoice and we mourn and we rejoice in the memory of Kyle Mathers, remembrance of his 25th birthday and the flowers given this day by his family. And thanks for his life. And we pray as well, as we heard earlier, for Ted Weil as he prepares for surgery. And we also pray for those who have lost recently, prayers for Teresa Dunbar and the death of her dad, for Susan Davies and the death of her brother-in-law. We pray for Maureen Nelson's granddaughter, Bryn, for Juanita Nelson and family who just tested positive for COVID, for Gabriella, niece of Sophia Brown, and for all of their family as Gabriella faces this difficult time with cancer and going into hospice. We pray for Mary Ruth Phillips' sister, Elizabeth, who has a diagnostic test this week. And in all these prayers, in both the sorrow and the joy, we remember that God is with us in both sorrow and joy, and that our prayers are prayers that are heard always. So together, trusting in our God, who is coming, who is the God of joy, even in sorrow, especially in sorrow, let us pray. Lord of glory, Savior of all who call on you, we pray for your people who are near to our hearts today and to yours. We rejoice with those who rejoice, whose hopes and dreams have come true today. Let our mouths be filled with laughter. Let all of us sing songs of joy, like Mary, like Elizabeth. For you have done great things for your people, and we give you thanks, O God. And yet we also weep, dear Lord, with those who weep. We call out on behalf of those whose lives are dry and barren, for all who long to be restored. Where there are tears or suffering or illness or grief, may there be songs of joy again. We pray for those who are ill, especially those who have been taken with this disease, this illness, this virus called COVID. We pray for all those who are helping to fight it. Healthcare workers, first responders, lab techs, and scientists who have come up, thankfully, with the vaccine. And we rejoice that that vaccine is beginning to get out, and we see light at the end of what has been and may yet still be a long tunnel, but light nonetheless. And the darkness will not overcome it. Lord, we lift up the prayers of your people, with longing, with hope, trusting that you will bring forth a harvest of joy. This we pray, as we pray all things, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, friends, as we come now to this time of offering, remind you that we are continuing to receive your offerings both by mail or by dropping off at the church office or by giving online. All those things you can do to help make the ministry you saw on your screens as you heard the anthem from our Trinity ringers, that ministry that is touching the hearts and minds and lives of people in our community and even around the world. Your gifts make it happen. And you can give online with the link you'll see in the chat that's just been posted there. You can also know that we are in the midst of truly miraculous acts of giving, acts of light and love in the community. Link gave out so much food yesterday with the food distribution and with the toy distribution as well. Food for Neighbors has supplied schools with food. We've been giving and helping to give food to Herndon Elementary School children in need. Lunch for the Soul has given out 35 pairs of shoes and 58 winter coats, along with 118 warm meals every week throughout this pandemic. And even while the Trinity Preschool has had to close for the time being, with Virginia being in the red zone with a high count of COVID, Service and Mission has supported this ministry of the church with a gift so that furloughed staff do not go without financial support around Christmas. And people are just being people filled with love and joy that God gives, that God shares, and uses us to share. So we invite you to give of yourself and know that in your giving, God is giving and joy and grace and hope and peace abounds. Even singing birds in the background of Becca's patio. We give thanks for it all. And one way we give thanks, just like Mary, is we sing. So let us join in the singing of the doxology.
Straight shall be what comes.
we do on this second Sunday of each month, we offer an invitation to discipleship. It is an invitation to be a disciple of Jesus here with this gathering, with this community, with this church we call Trinity Presbyterian in Herndon. If you feel God is calling you, if you feel you are looking for a church family with which you might serve the Lord, we invite you to make it known in the chat function that you would like to join with us, and we'll gather together with you, our pastors, a couple of elders from our session to receive you into membership. And now we also say, go in peace. Have courage. Hold fast to that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Support the weak. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Honor everyone. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
And may the love of God and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the joyful fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and abide in you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.